painful, but it was all right, I could use my hand. And she said, you never treat burns like that. And you know, only years, well, not years, maybe decades later, they discovered in their wisdom that the way to treat serious burns, people with serious burns, is to submerge them in tanks of cold water to accelerate healing process. But she knew little things like that. Our first house was a Victorian house in Highgate, Shepherd's. It was actually haunted. And it wasn't a very nice ghost that used to speak. Usually when my parents were out, and I'm sure the thing did it deliberately because I was in the house alone. I could never understand what it was saying. There was a distinct voice, although it was actually coming out of the wall. On two or three occasions, I glimpsed the figure in the corridors.
How old were you?
Oh, Jane, I couldn't have been more than about 7 or 8.
Okay.
And my mother told me, I told her about it. I told my father, he said, don't talk to someone, nonsense, you know, the ghosts don't exist. But my mother's attitude was, yes, there may be something here, but don't be frightened of it, because these things can't often harm you. They're just reflections, mostly, of things that maybe happened in the past. And she gave me insight into unexplained phenomena, ghosts, which other people just didn't have. I think that's what started me off on my direction of looking into ghost cases.
Yeah, I think that, you know, from what I know, that just the difference between David's mum and his dad, I think that sort of conflict with, you know, his dad saying, condemning everything, no, don't be ridiculous, don't talk nonsense, and whereas your mum, even though she died when you were quite young, was kind of nurturing this, and you knew this, I think that conflict plays itself out throughout the whole of David's life, because on the one hand, you continue to kind of explore these, obviously quite extensively, but on the other hand, there's an element of you which it doesn't forget, but it also questions it, and, you know, I think this continues throughout his life, and I just want, can I have permission to read,
It's your book.
It's not my book. And it's just, this takes place in that Victorian house that he said was haunted, and it gives an insight into his parents, but also maybe hints a little bit about David's, I'm not being patronising him at all, David's imagination. I mean, he has an extraordinary imagination, and which is grounded in very real things, but this is just an insight into him looking at his parents slightly objectively, actually. I vaguely recall my father sitting in an old armchair by a huge coal fire, a large newspaper resting on his lap as he looks over the rim of his glasses. He was usually dressed in a dark suit with a waistcoat, always with a tie, but sometimes in slippered feet that looked uncannily out of place as they shifted on the carpet. Can you hear me, by the way? Okay. His shiny black hair was always immaculately combed, at least never seemed out of place, as was the custom in the somewhat conformist days of the 1950s. Near him, in the corner of a large settee, sat my mother, and I noticed she was always moving and laughing, voice often mingling with the radio in the background. They both looked orange in the firelight, and the room was large, gigantic shapes and shadows, literally seeming to swallow up the furniture. In retrospect, perhaps such scenes only serve to increase some unaccountable longing towards the unknown. To childish eyes, viewing things which, although real, seemed almost magical and distantly removed from the world of everyday reality. I was too young to give such matters of immediate analysis, although it is a fact that any innermost quest remained locked up inside of me, and for many years during my early childhood, I preferred to be alone. And I think that this introspection and kind of and quest and sort of exploring quite frightening things that David experienced privately and then later on we know publicly is interesting. But there's another aspect which is slightly just kind of out of sync with What
are you going to say?
No, I'm not. No, it's just that he goes on immediately after where I've just finished. He says he wasn't entirely alone. So you think that the book is going to kind of continue with a slightly ghostly aspect. But no, he goes on to talk about animals and soon after Spike Milligan. So he keeps, you kept many, many different animals, mice, rabbits, budgerigars, guinea pigs, wild ones that you found in the country that were kind of injured, rabbits, pigeons, all sorts of things. I mean, the house, he says, literally began to fill up with animals, and he acquired large collections of mice, snakes, lizards. the mice were given to me by Spike Milligan, who lived just across the road and was a frequent visitor to the house for coffee. He was very impressed by David's collection of animals, and he gave him a cage of white mice. He didn't have time to look after them properly. and your mother kind of reluctantly agreed.
She didn't really want to have them, but she was too embarrassed
just
to tell
you
him
had
no.
A zoo in your house.
Yes, he was a real sort of extrovert. Oh, firstly, he said to me in front of my mother, "I've got some mice for you, I can't, you know."
And you remember
she couldn't say no, so he turned up this great cage of mice, and he started brooding.
Right.
And this, what started off as about 10 or 12, ended up with about 30.
Started to take over, yeah. So there are all these different, this book is absolutely rich with things like this, you know, things that kind of make you forget and remember, you know, this kind of journey towards the supernatural. And I'm really interested in this conflict that I see occurring throughout the whole book. And I just want you to talk a little bit about your experiences of just being a teenager, because it would have been during the 60s, wouldn't it? I mean, the 60s. David, a teenager, hitching, you know, he'd run away from school. You were very interested in just, all these things, drugs and alcohol, and you met some exceptional people.
Not drugs.
Not drugs, sorry, not
alcohol,
drugs.
Alcohol, yes.
You were definitely privy to witnessing, you know, there was a kind of curiosity, whether you partook in it yourself, there was a curiosity in what it was doing to other people.
Yes.
But maybe talk a little bit about this time in your life where you were kind of on the
road. Well, at school I was a bit of a... What's the word, rebel? I just didn't want to learn anything. Now, one of my schools, believe it or not, which is, I've already said it, so I'll say it again. I just refused to learn. I just didn't think material knowledge was important. I mean, I'm talking about instinctively. It's not something that I cultivated. I couldn't stand maths, algebra, geometry. Didn't mind English too much, but everything else, I just, at that school anyway. And it's because I just persistently refused to learn and do homework and upset the other boys, as they put it. They asked me to leave. This was Hendon Preparatory School. Then I went to a boarding school in Sussex, and that's the period when my mother died, obviously 13. I wasn't expelled from that school, but I actually ran away from it.
You ran away a few times, didn't you?
I ran away twice. First time I was apprehended by a teacher. The second time I planned it. And stopped up the field, I went through the woods, and I got back to London.
Mm-hmm.
My father sent me back again. I wasn't expelled from that school, but apparently the headmaster said, "Look, he's just not going to learn anything. You know, you might as well take him away from the school." Third school was Weymouth. That was a private school.
Mm.
It was the same principle. I refused to learn German. I didn't think material knowledge was necessary. Funny enough, the only subject I was interested in at this Weymouth school, apart from the girls.
Yeah, that's the subject.
It's scripture. I came top of the class in scripture. I really was interested. That's only because I took an interest.
Did you like it? Was it part of the teacher, or was it was just a subject?
You mean, was it part of what you call it, the curriculum?
Was it the person that taught you?
No, no, it was the subject. In fact, I didn't often agree with the way he taught it.
Okay.
I thought it was wrong in what he said, because he was quoting the Bible too literally.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought it doesn't mean that at all. Those are the words of men being put into history. But anyway, I came to open scripture. Where, at that school, what happened was, it was in the days, 61. Now, a lot of people here probably wouldn't remember this period, but it was in the days when people, everybody had short back and sides. If your hair came over your collar, you had to get it cut. And at school I let my hair grow.
Yeah, something tells me you didn't listen to it.
Well, we had a visiting barber, and he used to call his wardens the barber shop, which was really a converted classroom, or rather, which had his equipment in it, or something. And he used to cut the boys' hair, and it used to give them short back and sides, and I couldn't stand it. I couldn't stand it because my father was always making me get my hair cut. I wanted to have long hair. I refused to get it cut. I said, enough is enough. I'm not getting my hair cut. I left school for the day. I went down and lay on the beach. And I came back, and I was confronted by the headmistress. And she had the audacity, I've got to let you, you don't seem to understand. Long hair is dirty. I felt like saying to her, yeah, women have got long hair. So how do you explain that? Anyway, I refused to get it cut. He said, well, I'm going to give you a choice. He said, this is such a bad example to the other boys. You get your hair cut, you're going to have to leave the school. So I said, I prefer to leave the school. He let me stay on to the end of the term. There's only about 3 weeks left. And that's the end of my school days. I have to keep it short, but I left England then. I was 15 years old, and I hitchhiked down to Marseille. I was doing odd jobs down there, which were quite difficult to get. And I ended up going down to Sicily, where I hitched all the way, because I wanted to boat the journey up. I wanted to stop and meet the people.
Yeah, well, you met all sorts of interesting people on the way.
Yeah, sure did.
Yeah, it's pretty racy, some of this, but I don't know how many people have actually read it, but there's some pretty saucy passages which we might be going into. But yeah, David did meet a lot of interesting people. moving on. Yeah, there's. I mean, I'm quite interested in that, in the hitching, and because again, it's this conflict between kind of thinking about the supernatural, but also feeling, at one point when he's kind of tramping around his room, which is countryside, and he feels, you say you felt freer than, and happier than you'd ever got before. I mean, given that you had this sort of, you know, you weren't happy at school, it does make sense that you've finally broken free of lots of boundaries. And once you start breaking through some boundaries, then you kind of, you just can continue,
you
to explore
your natural ones.
Yeah, you continue exploring that. So I don't know, there are lots of parts in the book where David talks about sort of damning anything material and damning the flesh and anything that's not sort of supernatural, but you really explore things that are kind of, you know, sort of what we construe as kind of material and flesh bound, and just, you know, very much kind of on the earth, and just things that lots of people were kind of exploring in the 60s and 70s.
Mm.
So can you, I'm just interested in your kind of, in your sort of experience of that conflict. I mean, did you go through periods where you were just enjoying this freedom and then you were kind of forgetting about this interest in the supernatural, or was it always there? Was it always driving you onwards?
Interest in the supernatural has always been the underlying thing.
Okay.
The unknown supernatural, from my direction of looking into ghost cases.
Yeah, I think that, you know, from what I know, that just the difference between David's mum and his dad, I think that sort of conflict with, you know, his dad saying, condemning everything, no, don't be ridiculous, don't talk nonsense, and whereas your mum, even though she died when you were quite young, was kind of nurturing this, and you knew this, I think that conflict plays itself out throughout the whole
painful, but it was all right, I could use my hand. And she said, you never treat burns like that. And you know, only years, well, not years, maybe decades later, they discovered in their wisdom that the way to treat serious burns, people with serious burns, is to submerge them in tanks of cold water. I could never understand what it was saying, but there was a distinct voice that was actually coming out of the wall. On two or three occasions, I glimpsed the figure in the corridors.
How old were you?
Oh, Jane, I couldn't have been more than about 7 or 8.
Okay.
And my mother told me, I told her about it. I told my father, he said, don't talk to someone. Monsters, you know, the ghosts don't use water to accelerate the healing process. But she knew little things like that. Our first house was a Victorian house in Highgate, Shepherd's. It was actually haunted. And it wasn't a very nice ghost that used to speak. Usually when my parents were out, and I'm sure the thing did it to oh, deliberately, because I was in the house for this. But my mother's attitude was, yes, there may be something here, but don't be frightened of it, because these things can't often harm you. They're just reflections, mostly, of things that maybe happened in the past. And she gave me insight into unexplained phenomena, ghosts, which other people just didn't have. I think that's what started me off.